This is Babette Babich, and I teach philosophy at Fordham University in New York. And this lecture is based on a brief essay published in the Italian Journal of Metaphysics this past spring, and was written in honor of Jean-Luc Nancy at the invitation of Christophe Perrin, who was at the time at the Université de Louvain, Louvain-la-Neuve. I dedicate this video lecture version to Jean-Luc Nancy, but also to Fordham University's own Professor Emerita of Art History, Professor Irma Jaffe, as well as to round out a trinity, as this is only fitting, Professor Doctor, I should say, because of his work on Karl Rahner, the theologian, Leo, and also, I should say, Father Leo O'Donovan, S.J., who was for many years president of Georgetown University, and who writes on both theology, Karl Rahner is mentioned, and art history, particularly Ellsworth Kelly, but others as well. I also mention my friend, the late Cyril Barrett, S.J. In what follows, I talk about, just because the entire journal was dedicated to scholarly articles exploring the Annunciation paintings and the concept, all of them in honor of Jean-Luc Nancy, all from the perspective of philosophy, including a stunning contribution by Professor François Dastur. And when it wasn't from the perspective of philosophy, it was from that of art history. I note that in the critical literature, feminist readings of the Annunciation are often thematized, and these are critically key to what I'm about to say, although I refer to them barely and in passing, but they're important. The vocal concern, for me, is personal intrigue. Thus, this essay offers a hermeneutic reading, less of the presumptive purity of our perception of the various paintings of the Annunciation motif, as of its reception, involving a distinction to be noted between male and female subjects, reviewing a recollection of the divine inclination to beauty in both pagan, Greek, and Judeo-Christian traditions, adverting thus to the parabolic as to the salvific, and to the question of redemption by means of faith, the word only. The essay, the lecture you're about to hear, concludes by noting the terror of angels and being in the image of, like unto God. And the title is Announcings. To speak about the doctrine of the Immaculate Conception is also to evoke the beauty of the sheer idea of the Immaculate Conception, and following Stendhal's conviction that la beauté n'est que la promesse de bonheur, the beautiful is only the promise of happiness, as this maxim from Stendhal has also found its expression in Alexander Nehamas, where he writes in his book, he titles his book, as a kind of homage, only a promise of happiness on, it's all about, that's also the subtitle, on the place of beauty in a world of art. This same ideal of the unsullied, of the immaculate, is also a perspective expressing and expressed from a male perspective, ideal, a perspective ideal that is masculine, if it also captivates woman's fantasies, no less. By contrast with this conception of the Immaculate, there's no shortage of paintings that offer more, as Nehamas suggests, referring to the not particularly sacred example of William Adolphe Bouguereau's seated bather, 1884, conventionally sensual ideations of the female object, likewise from the male perspective. Thus, Nehamas clarifies Bouguereau's painting with a kind of gentle apology, and I'm quoting Alexander, as primarily a painting for men. The quote is from his Only a Promise of Happiness, and once again, for those who want to look at the book, The Place of Beauty in a World of Art, published by the University of Princeton Press in 2007. Nehamas continues to explain, and here I quote, that the open picture plane and spatial recession of Bouguereau's picture issue an invitation to the viewer and encourage him to enjoy the radiant sensuality of the young woman's flesh, soft and bright against the dark and craggy background. That's a quote from Nehemas. Elsewhere, I have emphasized the regrettable, from my point of view, lack of paintings that might be described similarly, that is, as primarily paintings for women, just because there are effectively none of these. What sensual depictions of men may be found in art are likewise primarily paintings for men. What I mean by saying that is only the same point that so-called guerrilla girls in art history and museum studies have also sought to make in different activist ways. My point is only theoretical, and I explore this in my own book, The Hallelujah Effect, talking, as I do there, about the differences between male and female desire. And I talk about this, too, with specific attention to art, and indeed to museum exhibits, in an essay I published in the journal Culture Theory Critique entitled, and I do mean the title very deliberately, The Aesthetics of the Between, on Beauty and Art Books, Museums and Artists. What matters here is that women rarely take the role of the objective, subjective observer of the male, no matter whether immaculate or otherwise. And yet the idea of an unmediated apprehension, as Nietzsche mockingly spoke of immaculate perception in his Zarathustra, the title is von der unbefleckten Erkenntnis, immaculate knowledge, dominates all of our philosophy, all our politics, and all our ethics, our epistemologies, analytic and continental, our aesthetic theologies, and so on, and so on. One thing that you could notice about that, of course, is that that presupposes a God's eye view, the view from nowhere, immaculate. By contrast, however, paintings of the Annunciation allow us to view a very different kind of feminine object. Note that I am not here about to undertake to read this in terms of feminist critique. This has been done. But this particular object, qua subject of representation, is the means for nothing less than the salvation of the world. Mary is herself the highest human being, above Joseph, above all of Jesus's later disciples. And all of this happens by way of, by means of, a word only. The story is more complicated than we think, just as we might expect from a New Testament account. There are variations, some including non-standard gospels, and to a certain extent, the Annunciation as such is also the breaking point between Catholicism and Protestantism. Not all Protestants, to be sure, but a good many denominations exclude the virgin birth, and if and when they do, they exclude the Annunciation. Here, I'm going to talk about some images just to the extent that when it comes to the Annunciation, there are rather more of these than one can think. It's a common artistic motif and is often written about, so much so that one can hardly review the literature, and I'm not going to try. And just to the same extent, everyone is familiar with the Annunciation, even those of us who are not believers or who do not have, as the French psychoanalytic and philosophical theorist Julia Kristeva says, that she has her own Annunciation. And if this in turn is part of a certain esoteric cult of Mary, another part of this is bigger than what can be regarded as a classical focus on the eternal, bigger than what can be regarded as a classical focus on the eternal womanly alone. The eternal and the eternal womanly are different things. The Annunciation bespeaks a numinous and real encounter. The Annunciation is how the Word becomes flesh and dwells on earth among the rest of us. The Annunciation is ours. Mary is ours. Kristeva's identification of this as, I'm quoting her, a prior to the beginning, or, I quote her again, before the Word, as Gary Waller also cites Kristeva's claim to her Mary and her saints, is part of this. It's the reason it cannot be gotten around. But more than this, it is the very idea of the word incarnate made incarnate by sheer announcement. An angel, Gabriel, comes on behalf of the Lord to greet, to detail what is announced and to specify what it will mean and to accept assent. It's an RSVP. If we read the Gospel as Luke tells this, we'll learn that in the 6 months, the sixth month, and already sixth month, our minds are calculating that would be June, and from thence to December is only another 6 months. This can't be right. No, this must be Elizabeth. But just how long is this told before Mary's marriage? She's only just betrothed, and I cite the current and popular Catholic version for precision. Plus, I'm speaking to you from Fordham, which is a Jesuit university after all. The angel Gabriel was sent from God to a city of Galilee named Nazareth to a virgin betrothed to a man whose name was Joseph of the house of David. And the virgin's name was Mary. And he came to her and said, "Hail, full of grace, the Lord is with you." But she was greatly troubled at the saying and considered in her mind what sort of greeting this might be. And the angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favor with God. And behold, you will conceive in your womb and bear a son, and you shall call his name Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High, and the Lord God will give to him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over the house of Jacob forever, and of his kingdom there will be no end." And Mary said to the angel, "How shall this be, since I have no husband?" And the angel said to her, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. Therefore, the child to be born will be called Holy, the Son of God. And behold, your kinswoman Elizabeth, in her old age, has also conceived a son. And this is the sixth month with her who was called barren. For with God, nothing will be impossible." And Mary said, "Behold, I am the handmaid of the Lord. Let it be to me according to your word." And the angel departed from her. And that's Luke 1, 26 to 38. We have to do with a miracle, a miraculous appearance. For Gabriel is a messenger of God. And what he comes to tell the virgin is that she has pleased the Lord. Having thus found favor with God, Mary is told, "And behold, you will conceive in your womb and bear a son, and you shall call his name Jesus." The virgin is perturbed by the language used. She struck, was surprised to be hailed by an angel, troubled by the meaning of the words themselves, of what it is to think, what it might be, what it might mean to please the Lord and to be full of grace. And we know that, like Zeus, God himself finds that virgins attract him. He favors her. And on God's own behalf, the angel promises Mary wonderful things, not to be sure for herself, but speaking as vaguely as all divine communications tend to be vague, rather that her son will be great, promising that he will be called the Son of the Most High, and the Lord God will give to him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over the house of Jacob forever, and of his kingdom there will be no end. This is familiar. When one thinks of a child, one plans not only on a baby, but on all the great things that child might live to do. So Mary is promised a child with every glory that might be heaped on an unborn head. And to set her confusion at ease, she has no husband, the angel answers her, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. Therefore, the child to be born will be called Holy, the Son of God." This sentence might still be unclear, so the angel speaks parabolically so that she might understand, thereby also giving the faithful to think that where one miracle is at hand, any number of others might also perhaps be had. And behold, your kinswoman Elizabeth in her old age has also conceived a son, and this is the sixth month with her who was called barren, for with God nothing will be impossible. This is the kind of fulfillment prayer ordinary people will understand. A barren woman has already conceived, too old to bear a child, and she, this relative of Mary, and hence someone she knows, Elizabeth, is 6 months pregnant. The Old Testament is here reprised. A child can be born to those in old age as a sign of divine favor. The impossible can come to pass. But what is that but a regular conception, just with one with an elderly father? A conception in a man's old age, though difficult, is not unknown. But with an old woman, there one has the sense that this is a miracle. And further still, even apart from age, with a woman not otherwise known to be fertile, that is proven infertile, hence the language of barrenness, the fruitfulness that comes to pass is a sign of grace. We receive all things from God. The difference here is the absolute absence of the male. Mary, without a husband, yet with the favor of the Lord, is promised that the Holy Spirit will come upon you and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. As a result, that is, therefore, as she is told, the child to be born will be called holy, the Son of God. This is extraordinary favoring. This is the union of the divine with the mortal, and this congress occurs without bodily contact. This is the first line of the Tübingen poet Hödelin's Patmos. Nah ist und schwer zu fassen der Gott. Near and hard to grasp is the God, is the English translation of that line. It is through the Holy Spirit that the power of the Most High will overshadow you. And this is rare, as Hödelin goes on. Now I'm citing from the English version of his poem, Bread and Wine. For not always a frail, a delicate vessel can hold them. Only at times can our kind bear the full impact of God's. In German, der nicht immer vermag, ein schwaches Gefäß sie zu fassen, nur zu Zeiten erträgt göttliche Fülle der Mensch. And that's the title in German is Brot und Wein, Bread and Wine. This deity then is really new. This is not the same as the Zeus we know from his mythic exploits, not even the same as the Adonai of the Old Testament visiting and drinking tea with Abraham in his tents. But generation between divinity and mortal is also, and at the same time, well attested. And this generation takes place in just this way, that is to say, begotten, not made, begotten on woman, as the Greek gods had always done, thus Dionysus, thus Heracles, in English we call him Hercules, as Hödelin famously connects the Syrian, this is Christ, or as he reflects, oder er kam auch selbst und nahm des Menschen Gestalt an, in his Brot und Wein, Bread and Wine, as we hear this in English rendering, else he would come himself, assuming a shape that was human. That's Hödelin. Led to think, as we are, of other deities or merely and just demigods begotten on mortal woman. This god does not take the form of a swan or a bull, nor indeed as a shower of gold. Hence the association with shining beauty, rendering the temptation for Psyche, remember her, the beloved of Eros, to catch a glimpse of her Eros, to peek and look at him, irresistible, much less a thunderbolt, that blasts the mortal form, permitting the deity, in the case of Zeus, to take over both pregnancy and birth of himself, Dionysus, the twice born. His lover was Semele. She vanished in the blast of thunder. So, we might say, we love the story. We have all kinds of versions of it, in all kinds of creeds. The Annunciation tells us of the highest of all human beings, conceived without sin herself, that's Mary, so that she herself could be this vessel, so that she might find favor with the Lord, so that she might conceive without sin, blameless, the Most High, the Son of God. And her reply? Behold, I am the handmaid of the Lord. Let it be to me according to your word. The word? From her mouth to God's ear, and what transpires is the miracle of salvation, namely the incarnation. It is the divine taking full human form through the ascent of this handmaid of the Lord, who says, and this saying is essential, for with this the angel departs, let it be to me according to your word. Full competence, with God nothing will be impossible, is now combined with consummate incompetence, with the vulnerability unto death, which is the meaning of mortality, the meaning of being human. How shall we understand this? It turns out that just this story breaks Christianity itself in two. Not everyone can accept this literality. If the shadow of the Lord is sufficient, then the shadow of the Lord is compatible, co-possible with Joseph too, as the human or mortal father of Jesus. As already noted, virgin births, that is to say, accounts that tell of babies born to women who have no husbands, could be said to happen every day. We're familiar with paintings of the Annunciation. Some of these feature no more than an encounter between angel and virgin, as in Fra Angelico's frescoes. In many of these paintings, and the Fra Angelico illustrated here, is exemplary. There's a veritably Augustinian mirroring of both piety and purity between these two figures, one a messenger from heaven, the other the handmaiden of the Lord. There's the word itself, illuminated gold. The book on Mary's lap, as we see it, matters because it shows that Mary is no idler, but not less because the word made flesh is akin to the revealed word, the written word, the word in the Bible. It is not merely that, as Erwin Panofsky says, one of the iconic attributes of Mary is the book as such, the book of Revelation, the book of the New Testament, the book of the Bible, any book. We don't know what she was actually reading. And there couldn't have been a New Testament when she was reading the book. It would have to have been the original Old Testament Bible that she was reading. So Panofsky says in his 1958 study, early Netherlandish paintings, its origins and character. I quote Panofsky, the main attribute of the Annunciate is a prayer book. That's to say, this is how you know that the version, the Annunciate, is the Annunciate. Rather, and it's also important, as we know, from the tradition of the text, as St. Augustine himself tells us, but as Ivan Illich takes care to remind us in his book about books in the vineyard of the text. To read is always also to hear, because by reading, breath gives voice to word. It enfleshes, embodies, articulates the word. We see more than Mary's piety. We see that she's not otherwise comporting herself, rather as some other virgins might be said to do in their spare time. Her modesty extends, that means, to her spare time. That she has no husband means, as this will also be an issue for Joseph, that she has not known a man. The greatness of this child is that he, Son of Man, as he is also called in Mary's name and not in the name of Joseph, is the Son of God alone and the Son of Mary. And yet, Joseph is the father of Mary's son in the full legal and proper sense, in accord with canon and Roman law. to this day still binding in some communities, all that is needed for paternity, the sole thing required for a father to acknowledge paternity, is the father's own recognition. One acknowledges the child. That Joseph does not put Mary away when she is with child is all that's needed for the son of that union to be his own son. Fatherhood, in the sense of having engendered the child, takes second place to the importance of recognizing the child as of his line. Thus, they need to go up to Bethlehem to register for a certain census, and Joseph is of the house of David, which means that Jesus is, as Joseph is, of the house of David. The next section, with a quote from Rilke, "Ein jeder Engel ist schrecklich." But she was greatly troubled at the saying. There's two titles, two quotes. In another essay on the destruction of the power of sons, an essay on Günther Anders, entitled Angels, the Space of Time and Apocalyptic Blindness, I wrote on the atomic devastation wreaked against two Japanese cities, and in addition to my reading of Günther Anders, I quoted, as many people quote, Anders' own cousin, Walter Benjamin, who for his own tragically ontic reasons could not have known anything of these bombings, he committed suicide before the end of the war, but wrote of the angel of history blown backward by the recording force of his witness. There I quoted too, as I quote here, from Rilke's Duino Elegies, Ein jeder Engel ist schrecklich. Such an angel, every such angel is terrifying, would be one translation. Terrifying? Aren't they all, I wondered? Paul Klee, Angelus Novellus, is of course the possession of that was in Benjamin's own hands. He carried it with him. Gershom Scholem would inherit it. And we see, and we're used to seeing, reading that line in Wilke's Elegies with reference to Paul Klee's painting, Angelus Novus, which is of course the new angel, the new messenger. But for me, when I asked myself about that, aren't all angels somehow terrifying? It's really because, as I reflected, where are you when you see angels? Well, the answer in the case of the Virgin is a bit different from the angel inspired by the oddly staring clay painting of an angel confronting the wreckage of the past, facing the viewer, who is thus inscribed not into the future, into living life, but in just that same history. For Mary is named, greeted, visited by the angel Gabriel, who comes to her in the town where she lives with a message from God. Now, and to be sure, the angel should terrify, should disturb us. Mary's fright is more than justified, and maybe the angel himself is to be blamed. There's a reason we are warned not to kill the messenger. For how do we, placed where we are, knowing we can know and cannot know anything of the divine, of holy things, of good and of evil, how can we know, how can Mary know, that he, this angel, comes from the Lord? This is the, one could say, this would be the whole relationship between angels and demons in the Da Vinci Code. How do we know who sent him? And what's the spirit he brings along with him? What spirit comes upon the Virgin? And possibly, to abate the brunt of this and related suspicions, the Bruges painter Gérard David offers us dual panels in his painting, Archangel Gabriel and the Virgin Annunciate, thus separating the angel from the Virgin by a physical frame, two paintings like a bundling board, eliminating the possible suspicion of angelic congress. In other paintings, such as that by the master of Moulins, Jean Hay, Annunciation, the angel arrives like a visitor at the door, just as Luke's gospel tells us. Perhaps the angel is more than the occasion of an announcement. Thus in Hay's painting, as in many others, like Fra Angelico's, we also saw that before, and many, many more. Indeed, in most paintings, the angel comes equipped with a paraclete. Of the Trinity, a Father, Son, in this case Son-to-be, and Holy Spirit, all the members of which Trinity are announced by the angel, it is the last, the Holy Spirit, the Holy Ghost, who serves as instrument, organon of the miracle of the Immaculate Conception that is to transpire. This is the overshadowing announced by Gabriel. And the painter places the Spirit just above Mary's head. Still, we may ask, whose annunciation is it? For this is not, contrary to the title of many paintings, the Annunciation of Mary. She is conceived herself without sin. She's already announced, already called by name in the world. The Annunciation of Mary is the announcement of the coming of the Lord, the birth of the Savior. And this too is plain. Say the word only, so ventures the centurion, speaking to the Christ in his own bid for the salvation of his own son. And the Annunciation promises a gift from heaven, like the shower of gold that impregnates the sealed and secured Danae, the image of that. The gift is a child, unsullied by contact with a human father, begotten, not made. But it's hard to believe that a God who can do so much with the word only, in the beginning, made flesh, can only save the world he himself has made in this most circuitous and cumbersome of ways. But to say that proves it. You have to have faith. By favorite, and not just because of the proximity of the Roger Campan triptych in my own life world, the painting can be seen in the cloisters above Washington Heights in the northernmost part of Manhattan, just take the A train as the song goes, is the wonderful homunculus that represents the Holy Spirit. No paraclete in this case, but a little, white, veritable Holy Ghost, a tiny soul bearing its fated cross along with it, flying in, riding the characteristic shower of gold with force enough to blow out the burning candle. In this sense, the theophanic revelation that is so significant is the moment of encounter. This is the fulfillment of the promise of salvation. This is the moment of fulfillment. Even if it points to the crucifixion as the little white ghost of a soul already bears his destiny with him, as every child already bears his own future promise from the moment of conception. But this child will be the Savior, the Son of God. God become man, begotten, born of Mary, born of the Father. If we are all creatures of God, we can answer Blake's question to us as to his little lamb who made you. We are made by the demiurge or by God himself. We are made. We do not cause ourselves. But in the begetting that is here attested, the difference is a different origin. This is the wedding, not unlike Hölderlin's Brautzeit, bride time, between the human and the divine. The idea itself corresponds to the mystery of what it means for the human being to be said to be imago Dei. We are, if we are, capable of taking divine form. That would mean that divine form can be imprinted on human matter. The promise of the Annunciation is, just as Jean-Paul Sartre once mused, although he was not talking of the Annunciation, nothing other than our human, all too human, longing to be God. But that's also to say that, I quote now, quoting Nietzsche, as Jesus said to his Jews, And that's the point of the Annunciation, as Nietzsche wrote of this in his Beyond Good and Evil, the law, this is the quote from Nietzsche, the law was made for servants. Love God as I love him, as his son. I leave you with Nietzsche, and I thank you for your attention for this reflection on Announcings, on a series of paintings that we have had the chance to see.